So basically, you know, with the way that things are going nowadays, I think that it's coming full circle again. And the music scene goes from being, you know, really underground, and then, you know, the commercial scene is completely different to where they're one and the same. Mm. And then when that happens, it's time to refine the underground. And I think that what's happening right now is that there's, you know, we're looking for the underground again, and that it's very close, and it's coming back to where it's going to be fun. You know, fun music's going to be around, funk, reggae, that kind of influence stuff. And I mean, that's one of the things that we're trying to do with our record label Fort Knox is, yeah, you know, really cover all of the genres of music that we're into. And it's like, we've got this label now that consists of CI, which is a reggae project on our label, and you know, reggae, roots rock, electronic music. And then you have Impresarios, which is kind of like a Latin funk and dub group. And then you have Nappy Rhythms, which is like a funk soul hip hop project. Fort Knox 5 is kind of like a little bit of everything. And what we want to do is we want to really kind of just concentrate on putting out really good music that, you know, spans, that's unclassifiable. Like, to us, the downfall of the music scene and where it starts having problems is when people start putting genres on everything and start trying to market music in certain ways. Yeah. And a lot of people have been doing that because, you know, it's, you don't really know what's happening in the music scene right now. It's such a strange music scene. For instance, like for us, we used to sell a ridiculous amount of records in Germany, Austria, and Switzerland because of Soul Seduction being the amazing distributor that they were. Mm. And when they went down, you know, it was kind of like the beginning of the end for a lot of people, unless you found a way of, you know, really kind of refocusing yourself and realizing that, you know, the music itself is going to be much harder to sell in the future because of, you know, file sharing and peer-to-peer. And, you know, there's different ways of doing it. Like, you can still have a very good, successful career in the live music industry. Or for us, we focused on video games and video game music, and we became really successful at that. And I mean, like, this year already, we've done about 8 video games that we've had our music in, or you know, have done original music for. And it's the way that we can basically keep afloat in this industry is really thinking about future ways of making money.
What do you plan coming up?
Yeah, I mean, I think that in the future we want to really kind of start focusing on, you know, maybe doing some live shows. You know, we've been focusing on having a band. Like, that was our project kind of for the last couple of years. It's like, we all come from live band backgrounds, and we thought it was really important that if we can do this and we've conquered things as DJs, that it's time to turn around and to go to another level would be to actually have a full band where we can play that kind of music. And we can incorporate, you know, the live funk, the hip hop, the reggae elements and the electronic elements all together and kind of have a DJ thing as well as a live thing going. And it's just really interesting. And then even taking it further, one of my partners, Sid, who's you know, part of Fort Knox 5 and Thunderball, has gotten really into like the whole audiovisual aspect, and so he's been, you know, making video clips. So when we do our live show, we have everything synchronized from the computers. So when things are happening on my computer for music, we have things happening on his computer for visuals. So it's it's truly like an audiovisual performance.
It's everything's marriaged.
Yeah. Alongside, you know, having Rob on guitar and Steve on bass and a drummer and two MCs, you know,
jazz.
Mustafa and Ashuru.
How did jazz influence you?
I mean, I've always been like a huge fan of Miles Davis and Grover Washington. And, you know, I was telling you earlier that, you know, I was lucky enough that when we started, when we got everything started, it really kind of popped off for us in Vienna. And I mean, Vienna is like, you know, one of the ultimate jazz places, maybe, you know, in Europe, aside from in certain places in Switzerland, it's one of the ultimate jazz spots, probably, maybe even more so than Switzerland. And when we first got our start in Vienna, it was because of the Vienna Scientists and their all their relations, Jürgen Dremel and Reimann Flock, mm-hmm. and Rodney Hunter and Shai Bosan and Makosa and Megablast and Joyce Muniz and Shanti Roots, and people who have really good deep backgrounds in music. And I mean, when I came here, the second time I think I came to Vienna to play, Jürgen introduced me to Fritz Hahn, who's the guy who organizes the Vienna Jazz Festival. And Fritz took us to go see Pharoah Saunders at a very small place. I believe you might have even been DJing there, you said. And it's like, we got to be in a room with maybe 100 other people watching one of the legendary saxophone players, you know, perform. And I mean, it's one of those experiences that I'll remember for the rest of my life. And, you know, when I think about Vienna, I think about that. So it comes back to, you know, I'm not one of these guys who's like super educated when it comes to jazz, but I do know a little bit about it. I do collect records. I've been collecting records for a better part of my life. I've got a collection up to probably over 15,000 records. And I would say a good 1,000 are jazz records.
Mm. Well, Pharoah Saunders, he was a... I did the DJing, it was two nights, it was three nights, mm-hmm. so it was very interesting, and it was great performing, so mm-hmm. Will Calhoun and guys
yeah.
like that.
You look at this guy, and I mean, he's,
Matt,
you know,
Garrison.
He's so, you know, he has so much energy for somebody his age, and it's just, it's the music that's kept him young.
Yeah. I mean, as an artist, that's really the gift that you get back.
Yeah, aside from your hearing getting knocked out.
Yeah,
those guys are lucky though. They get to play the smooth stuff, so yeah, it's not as aggressive on your hearing as the DJ sets or the live band performances.
Or the
that
rock
we've
musicians.
Been.
Can you imagine rock musicians' their ears?
I couldn't imagine. I saw a documentary on Motorhead and the guy's like, it's so loud. Like he is like notorious. For Lenny from Motorhead's like notorious for just having his
letting
stuff the loudest and letting it go. And everybody in his band, when he says, here, turn it up, they all jump out of the way because they know it's just going to be a wall of sound coming their way. And it's like, I can't imagine because, I mean, you know, I've been pretty lucky with my hearing. I generally wear ear protection all the time when I'm in a club. I've got fitted earpieces and I've got a spare pair just in case I didn't have them. Mm. You know, we're outside now, but as soon as I go back inside, you know, I'll be looking to put those in. And you know, and it's just one of those things that you have to really take care of it. And I think that if you, you know, luckily a lot of people who have been in the business for a long time who know how to condition
that.
Their hearing to where when you're in these loud situations, your ears can adjust, and you know, hopefully it won't do too much damage. And after, you know, well over 15 years of DJing for myself, you know, I've still managed to not, you know, I go in for the checkups quite often. I check it out, and you know, I still have problems with hearing sometimes, but it's not as bad as you'd expect it to be.
You're not a rock star in that sense.
Yeah, well, Def. It's like, it's one of those things that, you know, I always tell people, that's one of the things, especially when you can always tell a rookie DJ, either it's a rookie DJ or it's a DJ who's been doing it for 20 years, by, you know, how loud they have their headphones and how loud they have the monitors, you know, and it's like, I remember when I first started DJing, I would have the monitors so loud, and I'd have the headphones so loud, and it's like now I have to try, I want to keep it as low as possible on the monitors and as low as possible on the headphones. And sometimes you get into a situation where you might be a little bit nervous, and if you are, in that case, then sometimes you turn it a little louder than it should be. Like, you know, tonight I got up there and I'm like, I'm not gonna, I'm not gonna.
Archibald's that we can be taken seriously. But if you don't believe that, then forget you all, cause we're doing a party party and have a ball. Cause we're everything we do, but I believe that things aren't always what they seem. We want to hold the screen and start the show, cause we go on a mission and follow.